Six of these settings don't even work. Some seem to have identity crisis. Can you guess what shade quality actually does? I sure didn't. We got data on every key setting from just standing still to 5.5 minute test run. Whether you are here to soak in game's beauty or max out your FPS, you landed on the right video. Hello, fluffy gamers. Let's jump straight into the journey. We're diving into the quality settings. And at very top, we have auto setting. Clicking on that, graphic settings switch to what you have recommended in simple overall settings. But you are not here for that, so let's get this journey going and expose those settings. Let's kick things off with anti-aliasing. We'll start with the settings at their lowest. Now, let's slide it all the way up to Epic. Ready for some smooth edges? No changes? Where is the magic? Well, turns out anti-aliasing is playing hide and seek in this game. Our first setting already doesn't work. You'd think this would be a game changer, but no. Next up, ambient occlusion. Ever noticed how some games feel a little flat? That's where this setting steps in. Adding subtle shadows and depth to objects, especially when shadows are turned on. You might not spot it right away, but check out this dark spot on the road. It's like invisible artist giving shadows a little extra oomph. Next up, screen space reflection. This is all about adding realistic reflections to the surfaces. And while the ocean gives us just a hint of shine, let's take a closer look at the lake. See how the trees mirror on the water? Pretty cool, right? This setting adds a touch of realism that might just make you stop and admire the view. It's a small touch, but when you spot it, it really brings the world to life. Now let's dive into the view distance. You'd expect it to add more detail the further you look, right? Well, a little. While it boosts the details up close and in medium range, on a grand scale, it actually adds some vegetation and tweaks some textures. But here is another thing. This setting also controls how far vegetation spawns. Also, those textures are the same what you get from texture quality setting. Moving right along. Character count. It's not just how many players you see, but how many details you get. When you turn this up, it increases the visibility range for the players and NPCs, but when it's low, weapons and equipment might just vanish, as if everyone is traveling light to save some rendering power. Next, we got post-processing. Think of it as Instagram for your game. Except it's more like applying a filter that makes everything look a bit dimmer. Not the most exciting feature, but it's all about giving the game a slightly different feel. And now we are getting into character quality. Sounds like it's going to make your in-game heroes look epic, right? Well, not exactly. We got four characters standing here. And as we slide the setting from low to epic, nothing. No change at all. Another setting that doesn't seem to do much. Now, let's bring in shading quality. Sounds like it should control shadows, right? Not quite. Instead, this one brings nature to life by adding wind effects to the trees and grass. Next to, we have shadow levels. First is shadow quality. This one's pretty straightforward. It adds shadows where they belong, and as you can see in the side-by-side comparison, it really brings depth to the objects. But then you might ask, what the hell is a distance shadow? At first glance, it seems like a regular shadow setting. But watch closely as it'll turn on regular shadows. Then shadows start appearing in far-off places. Also, you'll notice how regular shadows only cover part of this one building and distance shadow covers only partially the other building. But combine both shadow and distance shadow and voila, perfection. Let's head over to texture quality. Now here is a tricky one. You think it would make everything look crisp, but in reality it's kinda all over the place. First, it adds trees to the distant hill, and in on the city, no change. Mid-distance, well, it does add some textures, but weirdly enough, they are the same ones we got with the view distance. Even around characters, textures pop up randomly, no matter what setting you choose. It's like this setting is having identity crisis. It makes you wonder, is this setting really pulling its weight? Let's see how it holds up against the next few options. Let's shift focus to anisotropic filtering. This one's all about sharpening. It makes textures crisp, especially at the distance. Check out the roof tiles and the crop fields. Suddenly everything looks sharper, right? Even close-up, pathways and roads start to pop. It's like putting on glasses for your game world. And here comes effect quality. And now we're getting into action. Watch as ultra-fluffy Sanhedra takes on dim trees, or whatever they are called. But surprise, as epic this battle sounds, there is no difference in the effects. It's all the same. So what's the point of this setting? As we continue, let's explore the vegetation quality. This one is all about filling the world with the grass, bushes and even hay in unexpected places. Its range is also tied to the view distance, so if you really want to go green, you'll need to tweak both. Now before we move on, we have four settings that require post-processing. So we'll set it to epic. First up, depth of field. Yeah. That one just doesn't work. Moving on. Next, motion blur. Works, but barely noticeable. Chromatic aberration. Still looking any effect. Haven't found any. And finally, lens flare. It works, but it's so rare, you might blink and miss it. Does this combo really impact your game experience? Let's be honest, it's probably safe to skip these. So let's set post-processing back to low. What's next? Let's find out. Level of detail. This setting sprinkles in extra plants and random details across the world, adding to the scenery. But here is where things get interesting. It also has secret effect that we'll get to in a bit. Time to focus on character shadow quality. Pretty self-explanatory. This one focuses entirely on your character's shadow. And no matter what you are doing, walking, standing or fighting, it's all about making sure your shadow looks just right. But here is the catch. It doesn't affect anything else. What's in the spotlight next? It's light quality. Here is where things get interesting. Let's start with the base. And then crank it up to epic. Notice something strange? Why is only this one candle affected, while the others stay dark? Well, here is the secret. We pair it up with a level of detail. Suddenly all the candles light up. Pretty drastic, right? But even more so, we can see it work in a high graphics level. It's a bit of a mystery, but the visuals really shine when it's all working together. Ready for the next bit? Here is the rain quality. Well, this one is a bit of a letdown. Let's take a look here. Little closer. And here, still nothing. Seems like this setting decided to take a day off. Not much happening here, folks. Let's move on. Let's take a closer look at volumetric clouds. These aren't just fluffy decorations in the sky. Not only do they look great, but they also cast shadows that move with the light. It's pretty impressive, but here is a catch. This setting can really hit your FPS hard. Will it be worth it for that cinematic sky? It's up to you. And then we have volumetric fog. This one is a bit tricky. It almost feels like the opposite of what you'd expect. Instead of adding layer of fog, it's more like lifting it. Not the quite foggy effect you'd expect. And last four, we have shader preloading. This one won't give you any visual change, but it might impact your performance. Oddly enough, when we tested it on Epic, we actually got lower FPS. So if you are looking to squeeze out few more frames, it might be worth turning this one down. On to the next, hair strands. Sounds fancy, right? But in reality, nothing. No visual effects, no impact to gameplay. optimize large scale combat. This one is meant to help when you're in a big battle with lots of players, but here's the tricky part. It's nearly impossible to test. Does it really help, or is it just wishful thinking? We'll leave it on for now, just in case. And the last one on this page is use DirectX 12. This one is a bit of a no-brainer. It generally improves performance and visuals, so I recommend keeping it on. But if you start experiencing random crashes, turning it off might help stabilize things. Give it a try and see what works best for your setup. That's all for this page here, and now we can go back to screen page. And here we start off with the screen mode, full screen, windowed or borderless. Personally, I go with borderless, and here is why. It gives me extra 10 FPS. Then monitor. This one is simple, just keep it set to whatever monitor you are using. No need to mess with it unless you are switching screens. Then we have resolution. This is crucial, make sure you match it with your monitor's native resolution for the best clarity. Anything else might stretch or blur the visuals, and it rarely helps with the FPS. Next one is brightness, this one is totally up to you. And then we get to the frame rate limit. Personally, I go with no limit, but if you're running into lag, locking your FPS can help your GPU and CPU handle tougher tasks. Think of it like giving them a breather. And here is vertical sync or FreeSync. This setting helps prevent screen tearing, but keep in mind that if you use it, you can't set frame rate limit. It's a bit of a trade-off, but it can really smooth out your gameplay if screen tearing is a problem. Hopping to next is HDR. This one makes your game colors pop like never before, but only if your monitor supports it. And now we're getting into FPS boosters. First up, Nvidia TLSS. If you got an RTX card, this setting might be for you. First, we'll test it on quality level. Notice the subtle difference? Now let's push it to epic and watch how pixels start stacking up. The FPS boost is real, but does it justify the visual loss? Let's see what our other FPS boosters have to offer. You'll want to keep watching to see which method works best for your setup. Also, DLSS frame generation. If you got RTX 40 series card or higher, this setting won't boost your FPS, but it will keep things stable. No more heavy frame drops, just smooth gameplay all around. Think of it as a frame rate safety net. We also have Nvidia Reflex Low Latency. This one's supposed to reduce input lag, but to be honest, I didn't notice much of a difference. Still, if you are all about those split second decisions, it might be worth turning on. And now our second FPS booster. Similar to TLSS, but with one big advantage. You do not need AMD GPU or CPU to use it. It works for everyone. Normally, anti-aliasing would improve the effect, but sadly that's not working here. And as you can see on epic level, it looks similarly terrible as it was on TLSS. Two to go. Intel Super Sampling. This one is still experimental, kind of like Intel GPUs themselves. And now we can go to third FPS booster, and that is resolution scale. If you are looking for a quick FPS boost, this setting is your best bet. My recommendation, do not go below 50% unless you enjoy chunky graphics. Let's zoom in and see how it looks. Yeah, not exactly pretty. Push it too low and you'll be navigating in pixelated nightmare. There you have it, three ways to boost your FPS. Each with its own cost to visuals, so which one will you choose? That was a whole load of wonky options, but none of it really matters if you don't know how to set them up for your specific needs. That's why I've made another video that walks you through the best combinations, whether you are a lightweight scout, fast as an arrow, or a mighty king of details, whose hunger for power knows no limits, so click on the video on the screen. If the video isn't showing up, don't worry, I'm still working on it. Stay fluffy and I'll see you soon on our next journey.